Goedemorgen. Good afternoon. And welcome to the first corporate finance workshop. So I just had 2 hours with BA and now 2 hours with you. So I'm not that fresh anymore, but I am a bit experienced now with the whole studio. And so that should help hopefully a bit. So the program for today is as follows. I'll first do a bit of an introduction of myself so that you know who you have in front of you. Then we'll have a quiz together of 8 warm-up exercises. Well, there's like 2 questions that are quite tough already, so maybe warm-up is not exactly the right word. And then I'll take you through the 3 connect exercises that I posted online and that you have hopefully prepared already. So a bit of an introduction of myself. Here you see a picture of me over 10 years ago in the aula when I graduated from IBA. So the second year students know, but for the pre-master students, I am an IBA student myself, an alumni. And after doing IBA, I've done my master's in finance and investment, worked a bit in M&A, and then I started to work as strategy consultant at the Boston Consulting Group. These are some of the companies that I worked for when at BCG. Can highly recommend starting your career as a strategy consultant. So for any questions about that, feel free to approach me when you get invited to an interview, which is pretty tough. Also feel free to approach me because then I'm happy to help you practice with a case interview. I've done that with several students already. So here at RSM, I work usually on Mondays and Fridays. I'm here 2 days per week. With Corona, it's a bit more fluctuate. What I do is I teach the workshops for the first and second year finance course for both BA and IBA. I'm an internship coach for some students, and I'm also every year a bachelor thesis coach for 10 groups. So maybe you will meet me there again in your future IBA career. So we have 7 weeks until the exam. Every week a certain topic on the menu. So today is all about cost of capital, but weighted average cost of capital. What I expect of you is that you, well, first of all, that you come prepared to class. So I assume that you have followed the lectures, that you have reviewed the questions that I uploaded to Canvas, that you tried to make them. You don't have to finish them, but at least that you did a try, because then it's much easier to follow me and to really ask the real questions that you may have after having looked at it. Also, I expect that you actively participate. So I see, by the way, quite some people now in Zoom that have their camera off. It would be very nice if you put your camera on, because the whole reason that I became a teacher is because I like the interaction with students, that I like to see your face and see if you understand it and when you start to understand it. So please, if you're in Zoom, it will be very nice to put your camera on. Thirdly, don't be shy. If you have a question, that's what I'm here for. So please ask your question. About those questions and what the right place to ask them is. So for any content question, how to solve a certain question, please do it either in the workshop or post it in the chat or on discussion board. Start a discussion on discussion board in Canvas. And then you can start to react on each other's questions. Maybe you can solve it together. I will look at it every week. And when you cannot figure it out together, I will answer to it. I get really so many. I'm overloaded by emails always with individual students asking me how to solve this question, how to solve that question. And every now and then I even reply because I like to help people. But it's just so inefficient, and it's just the workload. It's impossible to reply to all of your questions. So that's not to be nice, but it's just because it's inefficient. So let's do it in an efficient way in discussion board so that everyone can see it and also see the solution. About connect issues, well, I hope there are none. It's just either you bought the book in your first year and you have the code. It was in your book. You use that code. Or you don't have that and you buy the code. Yeah, so it's either or, and just when there's really, really an issue, you can contact the publisher. So that should all be working now. Organizational questions, please reach out to your TA. And for any suggestions, like, oh, Celine, can you please next workshop discuss this topic because I find it so difficult. I hear many students who find it difficult. Please send me an email for those suggestions. Or also for like personal questions, career questions, you can send me an email. And here's my email address. But please, not for individual questions on how to solve this, how to solve that. Okay, then please get ready for your warm-up. Second-year students know that I always love to use Kahoot for this, but because there's a 30 seconds delay with YouTube Live, it's not possible. So I've now prepared it in PowerPoint. So you see this orange bar on top. This is our timer. So now you have some time to get a paper, a pencil, and a calculator. And then for every question, you will see the bar running, and that gives you time to answer the question. Please, if you know the answer, type it in the YouTube chat or in Zoom chat, or feel free in Zoom to unmute and to give me the answer. Yes, let's try to make it interactive. Are you there in Zoom? Can you unmute and say hello? Because I haven't heard anyone yet. Hello, hello? Ah, I guess you know what? I guess maybe here the sound is not working. That's the reason, because now I see you. Okay. Can we try it again? Can you say hello, hello? Oh, yay, yay, now I hear you. Okay, cool, very nice. Okay, good to see you and to hear you now, yes. Okay, good. We're going to start with our first question, a CAPM question. What is the CAPM return on a stock with a beta of 2, given that the risk-free rate is 3% and the market risk premium is 8%? Is that 8%, 13%, 19%, or 22%? Do you see the YouTube responses?
Yeah, the YouTube responses, people what say C. Yeah, a lot of C's.
A lot of C's. Okay, yeah. Not a lot of B's?
No B's at all, only C's.
Okay, cool. In Zoom, I also see a lot of C's. Someone who had C, can you tell me how you got to the answer? Because it's indeed correct.
Yeah.
Yes, Lara, please.
So you take the risk-free rate, which is
yes.
0.03%.
Yes.
You add the beta to it. And then you multiply that by the market risk premium, which is 8%.
Excellent. Very good. So this is exactly how you do it. And I'm surprised that so many of you have the right answer of C, because in the top three made mistakes during the exam is that people take the market risk premium as the return on the market. So they take this 8% and then they deduct the risk-free rate and use 5%. But you rightfully noted that it is already in the market risk premium, so it is already in excess of the risk-free rate. So very well done, and for those of you who thought it was 13%, this is a common mistake, and please, now that you've heard it, don't make this mistake on your exam. Now, if the actual return on the stock is 20% and not the 19% that we have just calculated that it should be according to CAPM, is this stock then overvalued or undervalued? I should have clicked.
So we got quite some B's.
Quite some B's, yeah. I see it here as well. Yes, excellent. It is indeed B. I see most people responding with B, so well done. Anyone with B? Can you tell me how you got to your B answer? Why it is?
So basically, if you have a 20% return.
Yes.
And it's higher than what you should be earning.
Yeah.
And for you're getting it for like a steal, so it's undervalued.
Yes, excellent explanation. Thank you very much. I didn't see your name, but thanks a lot. That's indeed exactly the case. So if your return is higher than what you should get, what you should get as compensation for the risk you're taking, it means that you bought it too cheap. Like that, it was a steal. That it was very cheap to buy. So if that is the case, if that happens in the market, what would happen? What is the consequence? What would a lot of other investors start to do?
Price would go up on the stock.
Exactly. Why would the price go up?
Because people would start buying it more frequently because the actual return is higher. But then to get the balance in the market, the price of the stock would go up and then it would normalize again.
Excellent explanation. Thank you, Nadja. Indeed. Then a lot of investors start to buy it. driving the price up and bringing the return back to the CAPM expected return. Very good. Okay, the discount rate, is that the required return on a financial asset of comparable risk? Is it the cost of raising capital to fund a project? Are both correct or are they both incorrect, and is it always just the interest rate?
Some C's,
yes,
in the chat,
in the YouTube, right?
Yeah.
Yes, I also see many C's in Zoom.
Also D.
Okay. Well, most of you were correct, because indeed both are correct, and this is something many students find very complicated because they hear all these different terms and they get confused. But these different terms actually mean exactly the same thing. So, and the reason is that there are always two perspectives, two sides to a coin. So on one hand, the euro is the cost of capital that it costs the firm to fund a project, but there's always an investor that has to give that euro, right? And from the perspective of the investor, it's the required return, the return that he or she wants, given the level of risk. So don't get confused when one moment you hear cost of capital, the cost of equity, and then you hear required return of equity. It's the same thing, it's the same number, but the one is just the company perspective and the other one is the investor perspective. But it seems like you guys got that already. So this is then your weighted average cost of capital cooking recipe. You've seen this during the lecture already. We're going to use it a lot in our workshop. So the discount rate that you use for a company, assuming that a project has the same risk as the overall risk of the company, is the share of equity of the total value times the demanded return on equity, and you can calculate that using CAPM, plus the share of debt over the total value times the demanded return on debt, minus 1 minus the tax rate, because the payment on debt, the interest payment, is tax deductible because it's a business expense. So we're going to work with that a bit later, but let me first ask you this question. Financial leverage, does it increase the equity beta, the asset beta, both or neither?
A YouTube chat.
Okay. I see in Zoom also a D, but also a lot of A's. Guys, you are really, really good. It is indeed A, and many students often find this very hard to understand. But think of the fact that your assets, so your business as a whole, the riskiness of your business doesn't change when you get more debt into the equation. Right, so if you have two competitors and one takes on 50% of debt while the other one is 100% of equity, the nature of the business doesn't change. They still go up and down with the market in the same way. So their asset beta doesn't change. However, what does change is the equity beta, because the risk to shareholders increase. Why does the risk to shareholders increase? Can anyone comment on that? Exactly. Excellent answer yet again. Very good. Yes. So shareholders get paid after debt holders get paid. So their risk increases. So the beta of equity increases. How can you calculate the beta of equity? It's a bit small, so I will read it out and then you can write it down because you're going to need it for the next question. So your beta of equity is your beta of assets times one plus debt over equity. That is the equation. And then you also see that your beta of equity will always be higher than your beta of assets when you take on debt. Otherwise, it will be the same. It will never be lower. Let's calculate with it.
May I ask something?
Yeah, please.
It might be a stupid question, but what is
no stupid question.
Equity of
And so it measures the riskiness, so the variation in return of the share of the stock. So that is of equity, and of the company as a whole. It's of the company as a whole, the value as a whole.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks for asking. So let's calculate it now for a company. When a company has an asset beta of 1.2 and a debt to equity ratio of 0.5. Some people already started to calculate. I see a lot of answers coming in. I forgot my orange thingy. Yes. So indeed, the correct answer is 1.8. So knowing the formula, you can just plug in the numbers, right? So the beta of equity is 1.2 times 1 plus the 0.5. Don't get confused, because for your WACC, you always have debt over total value, over debt plus equity. But for this formula, you take your debt over equity ratio. So don't mix the two up. Well, and then you get to an equity beta of 1.8. So you see here, because half of the equity is debt, you see that the beta equity is higher than the asset beta, because the risk to shareholders increases because they will get paid later. Yeah, also note that there are also other words used for it. So your equity beta is also called the levered beta. So this is when you take on debt. And your asset beta is also called your unlevered beta. Okay, then we go to a WACC question. So if we have this debt over equity ratio of 0.5, a cost of equity of 19%, a cost of debt of 6%, and a tax rate of 30%. What is your WACC given this information? Lotte, I will answer your question in a bit. What do you get in the chat? I see some.
Now someone is coming in. Tobias says D.
Yes.
I think the others are still calculating.
Okay. Well, very good, because it is indeed D, but I also see some people responding with A. It is indeed D. Let me show you. We had a debt over equity of 0.5. So the bit complicated thing here, not too complicated, but you have debt over equity of 0.5. And we need to transform this to debt over debt plus equity, so debt over value. Well, you can write this as 0.5 units of debt to 1 unit of equity. So this means that your debt over debt plus equity is 0.5 over 1 plus 0.5. Yes, and then your equity over debt plus equity must be 1 minus this part. So that is then 1 over 1.5. So that was a little sidestep that you had to make. And if you didn't do that, if you just used your debt over equity as if it was debt over value, you would have got an A.
Nasli and Beatrice ask, when calculating cap M, do you use asset beta or equity beta?
Very good question. You use what do you think? What do people think? So with cap M, you calculate the return on equity. So if you calculate the return on equity, which beta would you use?
Equity beta.
Very good. Yes. Very good. So just to wrap up this question, when you did that step of calculating, transforming debt over equity to debt over value, then it was just plugging in the numbers, and that would give you a WACC of 14.07. Can you show the whiteboard again? Can we show the whiteboard again, Marcel? Okay. So in the whiteboard, you see debt over equity equals 0.5. You can rewrite it as 0.5 over 1, because 0.5 over 1 is just 0.5. That means 0.5 units of debt equal 1 unit of equity. So 0.5 debt, 1 equity, and then you get debt as debt over value and debt as equity over value.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I thought that for the cap n you had to use the beta of the firm. So can you conclude that the beta of the firm is equal to the equity beta of that firm?
Sorry, can you repeat that again?
So again. I thought for cap n that you had to use the beta of the firm, but now you said you have to use the equity beta. So is the equity beta the same as the beta of the firm?
No, the asset beta. So what is a bit complicated in here is that when you use cap n to calculate the return on equity, which is what you guys are doing now in every exercise, then you use the beta of equity. But you can also use cap n to calculate the cost of capital, to calculate the WACC, but in a different way. So then you don't use cap n to calculate the return on equity, but you use cap m to calculate the total return of debt plus equity, then you would use the beta of assets.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, sure. And thanks for asking, because that's a bit that's how we did it last year in the first year sometimes. That's how it was used. So I guess, Jonna, you are a second year student?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, so you got, So your question is very right. But from now on, we will use cap m to calculate the return on equity. We will calculate the return on debt separately in a different way. And when we use cap m to calculate return on equity, you use beta of equity. And Lotte asks, can you say again what it was with levered and unlevered? So equity beta is also called levered beta, whereas asset beta is also called unlevered beta. Yeah, so when you see those terms, they mean the same thing. Okay, now we go to our most challenging question of the quiz. So a company that has an after-tax cost of debt of 5%, so here's already after taxes, given what the cost of debt is, and the cost of equity is 11%. It has a target WACC ratio of, the target WACC of 9%. And then this company wants to know, okay, so how much debt to value should my company have to get to this WACC of 9%? Is that a quarter, a third, half, or two-thirds? Debt over value is debt over debt plus equity. Thanks for asking, Romain.
People are still calculating.
I give some more time.
I got a B.
Yes, here as well, some Bs. And I guess some people still calculating. Lara, you are extremely fast, every question. And correct. Well done, it's indeed one third of the capital should be debt to get to this weighted average cost of capital of 9%. Yeah, and many more people are now coming in, like they got to this correct answer. So you just set up the equation that you know now for WACC, you plug in the numbers, and to solve this, you want to solve for debt over value, which is the same as debt over debt plus equity. And you know that equity over value is always 1 minus whatever debt percentage you have. So if you have 20% of debt, it means equity over value must be 80%. So you can rewrite that as 1 minus your debt over value. And then it's just working out the math, and you will get to a debt over value of 2 over 6, which equals 1 over 3. So then we get to our final question, which is more an intuition question. What is the impact of an increase in liquidity of the share, so the share, on the cost of capital? So if the share is traded more, higher liquidity, what happens to your cost of capital?
I'm sorry, my internet disconnected, but you asked something.
The question is, what is the impact of an increase in liquidity on the cost of capital?
Some people say A.
Yes, very good. Oh, and Lara, I just gave you a compliment because you were so fast with your answers and correct all the time. And now again.
Oh.
Yes. So again, exactly, the cost of capital decreases. Can anyone comment to that? Why would it decrease? Don't be shy. Just guessing. Okay, so if the liquidity of a stock increases, it means that more people trade the stock. Means the risk goes down because you can more easily trade it. So the cost of capital decreases. So clearly this is in the best interest of a company, because when the cost of capital is lower, projects will yield more because you discount with a lower rate. So what can companies do to increase this liquidity? Well, they can disclose more information, because when they disclose more information, more analysts start to write a report on them, if you should buy or if you should sell, and then the stock becomes more liquid. The liquidity increases and the cost of capital decreases in the interest of the company. This session will not be recorded. Yes, it will be recorded. It's live streamed on YouTube and it will be available tomorrow. Okay, so now we go to our exercises. We first have a company, and this is a rather easy exercise. So we have a company that has a target debt to equity ratio of 0.6. Cost of equity, so the required return on equity from the investor perspective, is 18%. Cost of debt is 10%, and the tax rate is 35%. The slide will also be posted on Canvas, absolutely, always. Now the first question is, what is the WACC of this company? And then if you're the financial manager of this company, would you invest in a project that costs 60 million, but that will deliver every year 15 million of savings for 5 years? So if you had not followed a finance course, you would probably say, well, 15 per year times 5 years is 75. That's more than 60 what it costs. I'm going to invest in it. But you're following finance, so you know already from last year, or you're going to learn now if you're a pre-master student, that you cannot do that. You first need to discount those cash flows of 15 with a relevant discount rate. And if the project has the same risk as the overall company, you use the weighted average cost of capital to discount this project. So that's exactly what we're going to do. I'm going to walk now there. So I recommend always a question like this, and every question, I don't see first. Yeah. Oh, thanks. Yeah. So I always recommend to approach a question, a calculation question, in a structured way. So start with the end in mind. What is it that you want to solve? You want to solve what the WACC is, which is, of course, equity over value, so over equity plus debt, times the required return on equity, plus debt over equity plus debt, which I sometimes write as value, times the required return on debt after taxes. Because payment on debt is tax deductible. Okay, what information do we have? We know, we are given that the debt to equity ratio equals 0.6. Now we're gonna do the same trick as we did just in the quiz. So 0.6 units of debt to one unit of equity means that your debt over value, so your debt over equity plus debt, equals 0.6 over 1 plus 0.6. And that automatically means that your equity over value is the remaining 1 over 1.6. Because these two should always add up to 1, to 100%. We know that the required return on equity is 18%. Required return on debt equals 10%. And the tax rate is 35%. Well, and now we just have all the information to plug this in. So equity over value is 1 over 1.6 times our 18%. Plus your debt over value times the return on debt after taxes, and the taxes were 35%. And that gives a WACC of 13.69%. This is the weighted average cost of capital for this company. So if a project has the same risk as the overall company, this is the discount rate you use in that company. Are there questions so far before I go to B? No? All clear? Okay, good. So now we want to decide as a financial manager if you want to invest in this project of 60 million. So for the second year students, I hope you remember from last year that you invest, you make that investment decision based on the net present value of this investment, which is the investment in the minus plus the present value of all the future cash flows. Now, there's two ways to calculate this present value. What you can do is you take the sum of every year separately. So you take 15 million, you divide it by 1.1369. You do this for the first year. You need to discount that back 1 year. You do that for the second year. And you go on until the last year, which is in this year, year 5. So with 5 years, this is very doable to do it like that. But you can also get this for 20 years or for 30 years. And I wouldn't recommend you to do it that way on your exam with so many years. So in that case, when there are many years, you can just use the annuity formula. And with the annuity formula, you multiply the cash flow, the recurring cash flow, for a finite amount of periods, with the annuity factor. And the annuity factor, sometimes it's written like this, so it's A with a discount rate of 13.69% and the T of 5 years. And when you write this out, you will get 1 minus 1 over 1.1369. So it's 1 over 1 plus your discount rate to the power of T in this year, in this case 5. And you divide that again by your discount rate, 0.1369.
Celine, a question.
Yes, please. Yes, Deborah.
It's hard to read it on the screen, but will there in the slides, will this also be like, will on also be in the slides, the whole calculation?
Yes, thank you for asking. Absolutely, the calculation will also be in the slides. I also understand that when you go to YouTube, it's much more visible. So the HD there is much more visible, and it will be in the slides. And I just try to talk to it as much as possible. So if you did a bit of preparation, that you can kind of follow what I'm writing.
Yeah. Oh, perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Question.
Yes?
Is it possible to get a formula sheet again this year like we had last year?
Yes, what BA also asked for it. I will upload the formula sheet from last year now to Canvas just so that you have it. But there are some things on there that you don't need for this year, so don't get confused, especially for the pre-master students. It was with a different lecturer, so not everything is going to be used exactly in that way. But I will upload that. And then for the exam, well, the thing is, I'm going to discuss it with Florian, because it's an open book exam, so you can also just have your book and see your formulas. And you have your own notes with the formulas that you may use. So that's different than a normal exam where you don't have your book, of course.
Yeah, okay, no thanks, that's fine.
Yeah,
thank you.
Okay.
Yes, another question from Louis. He asks, so in order to use the annuity formula, mm-hmm. cash flows always have to be the same?
Very good question. Yeah, they have to be the same, or they have to increase, but with a constant growth rate. So it can also be that it increases every year with 3%, but that growth rate has to be constant. And then you would not use this formula, but if you go to chapter 4 in your book, you can go to the summary in the end, you will see the formula for if there is this constant growth rate. Then it becomes like 1 plus the growth rate, and here you will have the discount rate minus the growth rate. So similar to that. So yes, it has to be either constantly the same or grow at a constant rate. Thanks for asking. We have more questions.
Lila,
can we use financial calculator? Thanks. Yes, it's an open book exam, so you can use anything you want. You can use financial calculators, you can use your normal calculator, you can use Excel. The only thing you cannot use is someone else help you, but for the rest, yeah, use whatever you want to use. Yeah, and I'm also I'm also completely fine with that, because I think an exam should test your actual knowledge, that you are able to apply it in the real world. So in the real world, we're also not going to say, no, you cannot use Excel. So it will really test how well you will survive in the real world based on your financial knowledge. Okay, then I'm going to continue here. So this cash flow, of course, is every year 15. Now, if you multiply 15 times this, and your investment is, of course, minus 60 million plus 15 times this annuity factor, what I recommend you to do, if you do it like this, always check what number you get here. So in this case, you will get 15 times 3.4588. And that's a number that makes sense, because we're talking here about 5 years, every year a payment of 15. So, but because of time value of money, you cannot do exactly 15 times 5. But it will be 15 times the 5 years corrected for time value of money. So it will be something less than 5. But if you see a number here coming out, and it's easy to make a mistake here if you use a calculator, or if you type it in Excel, it's easy to make somewhere a mistake. And if you get there a number like 0.0008, you know, okay, that's an order of magnitude, it doesn't make sense. 300 something also doesn't make sense. So you know, order of magnitude, it has to be something a bit less than 5. Okay, so if we now do this whole calculation, we get to a net present value of minus 8.12. So, would you invest in this project if you were the financial manager of this company?
No.
No, very good. Why not?
Because you have a negative NPV, which means that you wouldn't invest because it needs to be an NPV greater than 0.
Exactly, very good. Because otherwise you don't make money, you lose money. In this case, you would lose money, 8.12 euro. So especially for pre-master students, if you haven't had this, with an NPV calculation, the rule is if it's bigger than 0, you would accept. If it's smaller than 0, you would not accept. So you would not invest. Yes, please.
Can you also say that it's not a good investment unless it's meant to be for charity or something like that? Because then you're on purposely making an investment that won't have a positive return.
Yes, so if that is the goal of the investment, then that's your goal becomes completely different. So you are absolutely right there.
Okay.
But do expect that for your finance course, the goal will be to make money. So from that perspective, you would not invest there.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, we are almost on 45 minutes. So are there any questions for now?
I have a question.
Yes, please, Oliver.
Can you repeat again the when you find the proportion of equity over value? Because for me, I don't know, my math is not the greatest, I guess. So it's a bit confusing when you add one in the...
Yeah, okay, sure. Way. Yeah. So this part, right?
Yeah.
Can you read it when?
Example.
Can I? Well, let's. I think 0.5 is an easy example. You can see that. So, if your debt over equity is 0.5, it means that half of the equity that you put in is debt. So if you would put 500,000 equity in, half of it, so 250, would be debt. Right? And what you can always do, if you have an equation like this, you can always, underneath any number, you can just write divide by 1. Any number that you have, 222, you can do divided by 1. It's always going to be 0.5 divided by 1 is always going to stay 0.5. And now you see that for 0.5 units of debt, you have 1 unit of equity. So if you now rewrite that as debt over equity plus debt, your debt still is the 0.5. Your equity in this setup is 1. And your debt is that 0.5.
All right. Yeah, I got it.
Yeah? So, and now with our simple example that we had, we said for equity, what did we say? 500. And debt is 250. That means that the total value is 750. And indeed, debt over equity. So I should have written it the other way around. But if you take debt over equity, you get 0.5, right? And if you take debt over value, 250 divided by 750, you get 1/3. And this is exactly what we have here, because 0.5 over 1.5 is 1/3.
All right, makes sense.
Yes? Okay, thanks for asking the question, because this is a crucial thing that it comes back and back. So it's important that you get that and that you can do it quickly and see if you do it correctly. Thanks to you. We're going to have a break until 1, and then I see you back for 2 quite challenging exercises. See you then. Hello. Oh, hello. So I start in Dutch all the time. Okay. IVA, hi. Welcome back. We have two more and quite challenging questions from Connect to go through. Let's start with exercise two. We have here a company, Titan Mining Corporation. They have 9 million of shares of equity outstanding and 1.2 million of 8.5% semi-annual bonds outstanding with a par value of $100. And the equity sells for $34 a share and the beta is 1.2 of the equity. The bonds have 15 years to maturity and sell for 93% of par. We have the market risk premium, 10%, T-bills yielding 5%. So T-bills, then you know, ooh, that's my risk-free rate. And then we know that the tax rate is 28%. The first question is, what is the firm's market value capital structure? So what do they mean with market value capital structure? They mean what share of the total market value of this company? Please, oh, sorry. What share of the total value of this company is financed with equity and what share of the company is financed with debt? So that's the first question. Then the second question is, if this company is evaluating a new investment project that has the same risk as the firm's overall risk, what rate would you use in this firm? And that is, of course, then your weighted average cost of capital, because it has the same risk as the overall company, and the overall company's cost of capital is the WACC. Okay, I'm going to walk there and take you through again. So what we want to solve in A is, of course, the share of debt and the share of equity. Okay. We know that for equity, there are 9 million shares outstanding. For a price of $34, and the beta is 1.2. For debt, we know that there are 1.2 million bonds outstanding, and the price is 93% of the par value of 100. We also know that the coupon payment is semi-annual. So as a bondholder, you get twice per year a coupon payment. And the total coupon payment per year is 8.5%. Also, we know that the maturity of this bond is 15 years. So 15 years until maturity. Well, we can calculate the value of equity by multiplying the 9 million with the $34. And then you get to an equity value of 306 million. So that is this times that one. Then the debt market value, so not book value, but market value, is 1.2 million of bonds outstanding times the 93% of 100. If it was book value, you would take the 1.2 times 100. But we're looking for market value because you use market value in your WACC calculation. So if you do that, you get to a market value of debt of 111.6 million. Well, if you add those up, you get to 417.6 million. Well, this is in dollars. If you take this now as a percentage, you divide the 306 over the total value of the firm, 306 over the 417 is a bit more than 3/4. So that's... Oh, 73.28%. And of course, the remainder must be the debt, because the total should be 100%. So the debt is 26.72%.
Yes, there are some questions. One is, how did you get the debt value?
Yes, so for the debt value, I took the number of bonds outstanding and I multiplied it by the price, by the market price. And the market price is the 93% that was given times the par value of 100 that was given. So if you multiply the 1.2 million times the 93% times the $100, you get to a debt value of a bit more than 111 million.
Great, thank you. And Beatrice asked like a practical question, if you could write a little bit bigger.
Yeah, okay, I'll try to do that. I'll do my best. And also I will really talk to it. You can review my slides back and in YouTube when you will see it back, it should also be better visible, but I'll do my best. Okay, then in B.
As well.
Yes, please.
I have a question.
Yes, please.
Yeah, so the question said that we asked for the capital structure, but I wasn't completely sure what that exactly meant. Like, are you asking for a debt to equity ratio, or what exactly should be our final answer?
Yeah, so your final thing, thank you for asking, very important. So your final answer is this answer. So what was asked for is what's the market value capital structure. So basically what they wanted to know is what percentage of the total value is debt. So of the total value, what share is debt and what share is equity. And we have calculated that almost 3/4 is equity of the market value, and the other quarter, a bit more than quarter, is finance with debt. Thanks for asking. Yeah. Then in B, the question was... Oh,
another
sorry.
Another question from Victoria. Could you repeat, how did you get the 306 million for equity?
Yes, sure. Thanks, Victoria, for asking. So the 306 million for equity, I got that by multiplying the 9 million of outstanding shares times the share price. So the 9 million times the 34 equals 306.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks. Okay, so I continue. So the question was, what discount rate should the company use for a project with the same risk as the overall company? Well, if the project has the same risk as the overall company, you use WACC as your discount rate. So what we're going to solve is what the WACC is. And of course, that is your equity over total value, over equity plus debt, times return on equity, plus your debt over the total value, times return on debt, after taxes. Well, we know this one already, because that's our 73.28%. We know this already. We're going to now calculate what the return on equity is. And we do that, we do that by using CAPM. So the return on equity is, of course, your risk-free rate plus beta times return on market minus the risk-free rate, or your market risk premium. The information that we have given is that the risk-free rate equals, let me see that, where do I have it? 5%, that was just given in the question. The market risk premium is 10%. Well, beta, I wrote it here already, is 1.2. And the tax rate, the corporate tax rate, is 28%. Okay, so our return on equity is the risk-free rate of 5% plus the beta of 1.2 times the market risk premium of 10%. And that gives you a return on equity of 17%. Okay, so now we have the share of equity, the share of debt, the return on equity. Well, we know what the tax rate is. The only thing we still need to get is the return on debt. The return on debt is also called the yield to maturity. So that's the return that you get on a bond given a certain price that you paid for that bond. Okay, so to further understand this, it's important that you understand the formula for bonds. The pricing formula for bonds. Where am I going to write it down? So the price of a bond is the present value, the sum of all the coupon payments, discounted back. So, actually for that you use the annuity formula that we discussed before. So it's the coupon payments times 1 minus 1 over 1 plus r to the power of t divided by r. And clearly here your r is your rd or your yield to maturity.
Sorry, is that present value or price? Or is that the same?
It's a good question, and it's exactly the same. So the present value of all future cash flows you get as a bondholder, that's the price you are willing to pay.
Okay.
Yeah? So this is the price of bonds, same as present value of all your cash flows. Price. But you don't only get coupon payments as a bondholder, you also get the face value at the end. And the face value is, in this case, 100. Usually it's 1,000, but in this case it's 100, okay. So it's 100 divided by 1 plus to the power of the last year, because you get that in the final year. So we can calculate what the coupon is on this bond. So the coupon is, we get 8.5% per year. But it's twice a year, so every half year you get half of this. Times the par value of 100. So that means that your semi-annual coupon payments every 6 months as a bondholder, you get $4.25. That's the coupon payment you get.
Question from Julia.
Yes, Julia.
Could you re-explain how you started with this formula?
Yes, sure. So how I started with the bond formula.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. So the price of a bond equals the present value of all future cash flows. And the cash flows of a bond, so as a bondholder, there are two types of cash flows that you get. First of all, you get every half a year a coupon payment. We just calculated that coupon payment that you get every half a year is 4.25. But you get that every half a year. And so in total, we have 15 years. So 15 years times 2 times per year is in total 30 times. You get $4.25 as a bondholder. So that is this part. It's the present value of all those coupon payments, of all those 30 coupon payments. Then on top of that, you get the face value at the end. So over in 15 years, so in 15 times 2, in 30 half years, you get your 100 face value. And if you get the present value of those two cash flows, that's the price that you are willing to pay as a bondholder for this bond.
Great. And yes. Then Ximena asks, what is the age? And I think she means the one above the deviation. So the 1 minus 1 divided by, I think it's 1.
Ah, yield to maturity. This one?
Yeah.
Yes, this is yield to maturity. And what I recommend you to do, like if this is completely new to you, read chapter 5. Yeah, there it's exactly introduced, and you can read more about it. But this is the return. The yield to maturity is the same as the return that bondholders get if they paid this price for a bond.
I think she means the H by the coupon, by the annuity equation, when it says 1 minus 1 divided by HRE. Where is that one H?
This one?
Yeah.
Ah, okay, sorry. No, it's not an H, so that's why I was confused. So it's 1 minus 1 over 1 plus RD to the power of T. So there's no H. It's 1 minus 1 over
so it's
1
plus
1
and not
one,
not an H.
There's no H. No, it's 1 plus. So this looks like an H. Okay, it's 1 plus. Yeah. Also, this formula you can find in chapter 5. But I hope you understand the intuition that the price of a bond is the present value of all the coupons plus the present value of the face value that you get at the end. We know that the coupon payment is 4.25. So here we can fill in the 4.25. We know that the price of this bond is 93.
Sorry, wouldn't it be 42.5 instead of 4.25?
No, in this case, yeah, usually it is because the face value is 1,000, but in this case, it was given that the face value is 100. Yeah, so in that case, it's 93% of 100. And also the coupon payment also. So the 4.25, then this is what we want to solve for. The time, the number of periods that you get a coupon payment is the 15 years, but every half a year. So 15 times 2 equals 30. And also this 100 face value you get at the very end. So that's also to the power of 30.
Yes, we got two questions.
Yes.
Beatrice asks, why did we divide 0.5% by 2 and not multiply it by 2?
Why did we divide 0.5% by 2? Well, we divided 8.5%. So the coupon payment, this is an 8. That was given that the annual coupon is 8.5%. And since you get it not paid once per year, but twice per year, every half a year, you get half of that. So 8.5 divided by 2.
Yes, thank you. And Jorn asks, shouldn't the semi-annual discount rate be calculated as, in brackets, 1.085 to the power of 0.5 and not divided by 2, as it does not have the same value in a half year?
No, for the sake of simplicity, you can just take this as divided by 2. Yes, it's already very complicated, so here you can keep that simple. So you can just take divided by 2. But to solve now, what we want to solve for here is what this RD is, or in other words, what the yield to maturity is. And to solve it in this equation, you have to be a genius in maths, but I cannot solve it like this. So there's two ways that you can solve it. Either you use Excel. And in the next exercise, I'm going to show you how you do it in Excel. It's quite straightforward. Or you do it, you approximate it with interpolation. I'm going to show that now to you. Because it is important that you understand the whole intuition behind it and that you get it. If you have a correct or a wrong answer, that you understand how the dynamics work. Let me make some space here.
Okay, in the meantime, Lina has a question. How could we identify the 8.5% is annual, as it says semi-annual bond? We thought it would be the interest rate for half a year.
Yes, the percentage that's given, that's always the percentage for the full year. And because it says semi-annual, it means that you get it paid not annually, but every half year. So that's just the way information about bonds is given.
Yes, thank you.
Keep this as the 17%. Okay. So show you how to solve now for this RD. Or in other words, yield to maturity. The relationship between RD or yield to maturity and the price of a bond looks like this. There's an inverse relationship. So the higher the price, the lower the yield, and the lower the price, the higher the yield. Okay, so what we want to know is what the yield to maturity is for the price of the bond that it is. So 93, that's what we want to know. And how can we find this? We can find it by solving it for 2 points and then interpolate to this very point. So first you sketch the graph, and then there's 1 point that is very easy to get right away. So for the price of 100, so when the price of the bond is equal to the par value, the yield to maturity is equal to the coupon. So we take this semi-annual. So in that case, the yield to maturity would be 4.25%. This is always the case. Then we want to be a bit more left. So if we then take another point here, so for example, for 5%, what would the price then be? So we calculate now the price for the second point. How do we calculate it? With our formula. So in that case, so the price here equals the coupon payment. That's always fixed. That doesn't change. Times 1 minus 1 over 1.05. So here you take that yield to maturity to the power of 30. You divide it by that yield to maturity. And of course, you also still need to add the par value that you get at the very end. So you discount that back to the power of 30. So the price for this point, if you calculate this, equals 88.47. So this is your price for 5%. Okay, now we are ready to interpolate. We can just walk from this point there using a slope. So the slope, we can calculate it. It's the delta y over the delta x. So you can take the 5% minus the 4.2%. You divide it by the 88.47 minus 100, and that gives you a slope of minus 0.006505. So we have this now. And now what we just do is we walk from this point to get the yield to maturity. We walk from this point, so from this point here, and we want to go that part, so 93 minus the 88.47. And we multiply that by the slope that we have just calculated. And that gives a yield to maturity, semi-annual, we still have, of 4.7%. Well, now we have the semi-annual yield to maturity. We need to bring it to the annual. So we just multiply by 2. And it gives an annual yield to maturity. So your annual required return on debt equals 9.4%. And that's the number we wanted to know for WACC. So in the next example, I'm going to use Excel. By all means, for your exam, you can use Excel rather than the interpolation. But do know all the logic behind it. So do know what the relationship is between the yield and the price. Do know that the coupon equals the yield to maturity when the price equals par. So do understand the whole relationship so that you see if you got a correct answer or not. So we have this here now, that the return on debt is 9.4%. Are there any questions so far about this? Because otherwise I'm going to delete it to get to our final answer.
I don't think probably a very stupid question because I'm a pre-law student. But,
no stupid questions.
The coupon rate, it's like 8.5 divided by 2 times 100, but I don't understand like when it's semi-annual, like logically in my head it would be times 2, like in the end it's done, but why is it then 4.25?
Yes, no stupid questions. Thanks for asking. So the way the information is given is based on an annual percentage. So the 8.5% is an annual percentage. So per year you would get $8.5. But you don't get paid per year, you get it every half year. So if I tell you, Deborah, you get 20 euros this year from me, but I'm going to pay half, I'm going to pay part half of it in 6 months and the other half 6 months later, then you first get 10 and then you get another 10. So that's why you need to divide that by 2.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
I have thanks for question.
Yeah.
Why is the return on debt or the yield to maturity negatively related to the price of a bond?
Because if you look also here, the coupon payment that you get, that is a fixed payment. So once the yield goes up, when the interest in the market goes up, the price of the bond goes down because it becomes less attractive. Because the money that you get from your coupon payment is fixed. But on the other hand, if the interest would go down, you still get that. So if it goes lower than this 4.25%, if it becomes lower, then you still get this fixed 4.25%. So then it's really attractive. So that drives the price of the bond up. Yes, is that clear? Thanks for asking.
Yeah, I have one more question as well.
Yes, please.
I think yesterday Florence said that we didn't have to calculate the yield to maturity ourselves on the exam. So I just wanted to make sure if that's true or like, because now you are kind of sending mixed signals.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for asking. So you don't need to, you won't get an open question because that has happened in the past, that you got an open question where you have to do this interpolation yourself. So Florian and I both are not a big fan of that because this is not what you would do in the real world yourself. But I am going to show you how you do it in Excel, and you do need to understand all the steps behind it because you can get a question around how to get to the RD or the yield to maturity. But you won't. We won't ask in an open question format, please show us the interpolation.
Okay, thank you.
But it's, yeah, thanks for asking. And but I hope you still understand, it's still important that you get this because it is the logic behind it. So that you know where it comes from, yeah? Okay, good. Well, then we are ready to just plug everything in our WACC formula. So let's see, our final answer is the equity over value, that was the 73.28%. times the return on equity. We calculated that with CAPN to be 17%, plus the share of debt, 26.72%, times the return on debt. Note that this is lower than the return on equity because it's less risky. So the required expected return from investors is lower. Times 1 minus the tax rate, and the tax rate was 28%. And if you calculate that, you will get to a WACC of 14.26%. Any more questions about this one? I think this is clear, right?
I have a question.
Oh, please.
So to calculate the debt and equity, you never use the formula. You always use the market value, right?
Yes, you use the market value, unless specified otherwise, but like in real calculation, you would use the market value and not book value.
Okay, thanks.
Yes, thanks. Okay, then I'm gonna go back here and read to you the final question. And you see all of these slides, I'm gonna upload it still today, so you can just go through it as slow as or as fast as you like. Our final question is about bottled water, a European company. And again, the question is, what is the company's WACC? So you can see that WACC is something very important. So you will see that back on the exam. So there are now four sources of capital. There are two types of debt. First of all, there are 8% coupon debt. So that's similar to the ones we just discussed. So you get a coupon payment. And in this case, it's not specified that it's semi-annual. But when it's not specified that it's semi-annual, you can assume that because that is the standard. Also, it's not specified what the par value is, what the face value is. If it's not specified, the standard is that it's 1,000. Then there's also zero coupon bonds outstanding. There are preference shares, which are a bit in between bonds and shares. There are common shares. And then there's a bunch of market information. So this would be a good example of a challenging question. So when we say 25% of the exam is noted as a challenging question, this would be one, because you have to go through multiple steps and we don't have just two sources of capital, what we've been doing so far, but here there are four sources of capital. Yes, so let's go to the whiteboard again and then I'm gonna take you through. So again, start with the end in mind. What we want to solve is WACC. And I guess you can dream by now that it's equity over total value times return on equity plus debt over total value times return on debt after taxes. We have a lot of information. So we have common shares. We have preferred shares. We have zero coupon bonds, and we have, 8% coupon bonds. So in total, four sources of capital. So each with their own required rate of return, depending on the risk involved with it. Okay, the information that we have. The common shares are 2 million. there's 2 million of common shares outstanding. The price is 65 euros per share. And the beta of the equity equals 1.1. That's just given. Then the preferred shares, there are 120,000 outstanding. The price is given to be 112. And the dividend is 6.5%. That's always 6.5% of the par value. And the par value is 100, so the dividend is 6.5% of 100. Then we have the zero coupons, a total of 150,000 outstanding. The quoted price is 13.85. And even though it doesn't give a percentage in the text, that's just how bonds are quoted, it means a percentage of the face value. So the price is 13.85% times a face value of 1,000. And the maturity, very important, time to maturity equals 30 years. Now the 8% coupon, how many were there? 50,000. The quoted price is 119.8%. Again, this is multiplied by the par value of 1,000. And the time to maturity of these are 25 years. A bunch of info, and then we also have some market info. We know that the risk-free rate is 4%. The market risk premium is 5%. And the tax rate equals 40%. Now, our first step is to calculate the market value. Okay, so we're going to do it here. I will first calculate the euro market value. And then we transform that to what percentage of the total value that means. So the market value of the equity. How do you get that? You just simply multiply the number of shares outstanding times the price. So that is the 2 million times 65 euros. And that gives you 130 million. For the preferred, you take the number, so the 120,000 outstanding times the price of 112. So it's the same procedure. You multiply the number times the price, and you get to a market value of 13.44 million. We continue. Zero coupon, again, just the number times the price. So 150,000 times the price, which was 13.85% of 1,000. If you multiply those, you will get to a market value of 20.775 million. And the 8% coupon, it's 50,000 times the price of 119.8% of 1,000. And when you multiply those, you get to a market value of 59.9 million. So these are all the sources of capital of the firm. If you add all those sources of capital up, you get to the total market value of the firm. And the total market value of the firm, if you add this all up, equals 224.115 million. Yes? Okay, now we want to know, okay, what share of the total value comes from the common shares? What share from the preferred? What share from the zero coupon? And what from the 8% coupon? Well, we can now easily just take that as weight. So the common shares, they are the biggest part of how the firm is financed. It's 130 million over the total of 224. And it gives you 58.01%. So 58% of the company is financed with equity, with normal shares. Preferred 13 over 224. That's only 6% of the company. Zero coupon, it's 20 over 224. That's 9.27%. And the final share comes from the zero coupons of almost 60 million over the 224. Gives you almost a quarter of the company. So 26.73% is from the 8% coupons. And just check, yes, this all adds up to 100%.
I have a question.
Yes.
From Oliver.
Yeah.
He asks, why do we have to calculate the market value?
Because you need it in your WACC calculation. So you need to know which share is from the equity, which share from the... So your equation here becomes even longer because you have four sources and you need to know for each part how much they are. Thanks for asking. So we will use those later on in our WACC formula. But first we are going to calculate. So this is our second step. We are going to calculate the returns for each source of capital. So for the common. The return, of course, is just the risk-free rate equals the risk-free rate plus beta times the market risk premium. The risk-free rate was 4%. The beta was 1.1. And the market risk premium was 5%. And that is a 9.5% required rate of return on the common shares. The return on the preferred. So the return on the preferred. You get that by taking your dividend. And you divide it by the price paid. So that's the return that you get on preferred. Divided by the price. Okay, in this case we know that the dividend is 6.5% of the par value of 100. So it's 6.05 that you get every year as a preferred shareholder. And the price that you paid to get that return, to get the dividend every year, equals 112. So this is a return, if you calculate it, of 5.8%.
I have a question.
Please.
Why is the return on preference share not including the return for equity? Is it not the same?
It's not the same, no. So there's a different risk that preferred shareholders have than that common shareholders have. So in the case of bankruptcy, preferred shareholders get paid before common shareholders get paid. And also the preferred shareholders just are much more fixed to a dividend than that common shareholders are. So there's less risk involved for preferred shareholders. That's also why the return that they demand is lower than the return that common shareholders demand.
So in the equation for the WACC, do we put them with the RD or RE?
We do them separate. So you will see that in our final step. So stay with me. In the final step, you will see that we need to take them separate because they have different returns. So
okay.
in the WEC so far, we just had two sources of capital. Now we will have four sources of capital. So the WEC becomes much longer.
Sure. If we have a higher preferred, a higher return on the of the preferred stocks, does that mean we did a mistake?
Yes, a very good question, Elena. That would be very odd. Yes, you would expect. Yeah. Thanks. Okay.
Another question from Bibisha: how do you calculate the market value of the coupons?
How you calculate the market value of the coupons? So we did it here. You calculate the market value just how you calculate any market value. So you take the number of bonds outstanding, 50,000, and you multiply it by the price. And the price is the percentage that was quoted times the face value of 1,000. So if you do 50,000 times 119.8 times 1,000, you get to the market value of the 8% coupon.
Great, thank you.
Thanks. Okay, so we're going to continue with calculating the returns. Two left. So the return on the zero coupon, you can quite easily calculate this with mathematics. So what you would do is, with a zero coupon bond, you don't get any coupon payments. You only get the face value at the very end. So if you just set up your equation that the price that you paid, which is in this case 13.85% of 1,000. So the price is 138.5. And you pay that price to get a face value of 1,000. And you divide that by 30 years times 2, so that is 60, and you would solve here for R. And you can simply do that by cross multiplication. You would get to a return on preferred of 6.71. But alternatively, you can also, of course, use Excel for that, which I'm going to show you for the final one. So the return on the 8% was 8%, right? Yes, on the 8% coupon. I'm going to show it to you now in Excel. So this is how you would use it, do it in the real world. Okay, so help me out here. What was the par value? I see some people talking, but you're on mute, so then I don't hear you. Par value, anyone? Face value. 1,000, very good, thanks. The coupon rate, the annual coupon rate.
8%.
8%, very good, thank you. How many coupon payments per year?
Two.
Very good. How many years to maturity?
30.
Very good. And, 25. 25. That 30 was, 25. And the current price?
119.8% of 1,000.
Very good. So that will be 1,198. Beware, this price, always put it in as a negative, because this is what you pay, so this is a cash out, so put it in as a negative, otherwise it won't work. And voila, here you have your return on debt.
I have a question from Cici, which is about the zero coupon formula. What is the letter under the R?
Oh, D, return on debt. So return on this debt. This one?
Yeah.
Yeah. Return on debt.
Oh. Can you show the Excel formula again? How did you?
I will post the Excel on Canvas, so you can just use it for all your Connect exercises.
Return on debt is just the sum of all these values.
So the return on debt. Remember when I wrote down this formula. So you solve for that the price equals all the coupon payments plus the face value, and then you have to solve for with what return you would have that equal the 1198. So that's quite a complicated, like, mathematical thing. And Excel, automatically, they have a function to solve for this. Yes? So the bond formula, we used it in the previous exercise. I wrote it down. And you can also look it up in chapter 5. So it's just the present value of all the coupons, which are an annuity, plus the face value discounted back.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Okay, thanks.
Also, Bibisha asks, can she read about these procedures somewhere in the book, as she's not familiar with any of this?
Yeah, so what I recommend is to read chapter 4 and chapter 5. So chapter 4 is about annuity formula, and chapter 5 is about calculating the price of a bond and a share. So there you can read about it. But yeah, again, I will post this Excel so that you can just use this to calculate your RD. Yes, so Elf is asked, it's 8% and pays out semi-annually, so 4% every half a year. Correct, yes. But how you fill it in Excel, you take your annual coupon rate and then you say how many coupons per year. But indeed, your semi-annual coupon is 4% of 1,000, so it's 40 euros. Lisa, I will try to upload it today, yes. Okay, yes, please.
Can you write out the calculation for the yield to maturity for the 8% coupon bond, like algebraically, how we would solve for it?
How you would solve for it? I can write it down, yes. So it's just the price of a bond is the coupon payment. So in this percent, that is 40. Do you want me to write it with the numbers in there or without the numbers in there?
With the numbers.
Okay, so the coupon is 40. Times the annuity factor, which is 1 minus 1 over 1 plus, and this is where you need to solve for. So this is your yield to maturity, or RD. I will now write down RD. But this is what you need to solve for. To the power of T, so it was 25 years, but twice a payment per year, so 50 periods. You divide this by RD. And then also you have your face value payment at the end, which is 1,000. And you need to discount that back to today. So that is 1 plus your RD to the power of 50. And in this case, well, sir, the price is... the price is 1198. So... you cannot solve for this mathematically, or if you can, then big bravo for you, but I cannot solve this mathematically, and I'm quite okay in math. So that's why either you interpolate what I did in the second exercise, or you use Excel. So Excel just solves for RD in this equation.
Yes, another question.
Sure, welcome. Very welcome, Victor.
Why do we have to assume that a semi-annual compound... why do you have to assume a semi-annual compounding, another yearly one? Can we get a list of conventions that we have to use for assumptions? Because at previous studies, they had to always use the annual compounding.
Okay, but that list would just be now these two. So just remember from this workshop, and you can review back the slides. What is the standard is 1,000 par value. But also, again, by the way, in the exam, we don't want to screw you guys up, so we will just give it so that there's no discussion about it. But just for you, if you're interested in finance, if you maybe want to work in it, just know that by default, if it's not written, know that what is quoted is semi-annual, that the payment is semi-annual, and that the face value is 1,000. So it's just more for you to know if you're interested in investing or going in finance. But on the exam, we won't screw you and we will give it to you. Yeah? Then let me wrap it up here. So the RD of this 8% coupon was 6.4%. We got it with Excel. And now we are just going to plug all of this in our WACC formula to get to the final answer of today. Is this bottom still visible? Yes, huh? Okay, so your WACC. It's your share of common stock. So it's 0.5801 times the return on your common shares, 9.5%. Plus the share of preferred, 6%. So plus 0.06 times the return on the preferred, so 5.8%. Plus the share of the zero coupon, 9.27%. Times the return on the zero coupon, 6.71%. Plus, wait, I forget something really important here, which you shouldn't forget. Of course, we're talking now about a bond, about bonds, and that is tax deductible. So we have to do here 1 minus the tax rate, and the tax rate is 40%. And then also the 26.73 times the return on the 8% of 6.4 after taxes, so after 1 minus 0.4. So, if you calculate this very lengthy formula, you get to a WACC of a weighted average cost of capital for this firm of 7.26%. That's it. That's our final answer to today. We're almost at 2 also. Are there any questions about this one or anything else?
Christina asks,
yes.
Why do you use in 8% coupon bond the price as a percentage 119.8% and as well as in Excel 1,198 since it is 119 euros and 80 cents?
No, it's not euros. It's just the quoted price is given as 119.8, and that means the quoted price is always a percentage of a share of a face value. So that's just how it's written. Thanks for asking, Christina. Further questions?
Something?
Yes, please. Always.
We have done a couple exercises on Connect, but there are, of course, way more on them. And someone actually sent a picture in the chat, but I don't think we have time for that. But is there some way we can find the calculations from these exercises?
So in Connect, you don't have the calculation of the exercises?
Well, at least I cannot find them. So like when you fill it in, you either know whether it is correct or whether it's wrong. But when I don't have the right calculations, it only says wrong, of course. So is there a way to find those?
No, so what you can do is start a discussion on discussion board, and then hopefully one of your fellow students knows how to get to the answer. And if not, then after a week I will reply on the ones that are not resolved.
Okay,
I know how you can get them. You can submit all your answers from the chapter as a whole, and then you can go through the answers, and they also show you the calculations.
Where you're at there.
So even if you don't fill out the correct answer, because obviously you don't know the calculations, you can still find them if you submit the whole thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks for explaining, Yvonne. I didn't know you guys had. Good. Any other questions? Okay. No?
Lisa asks, isn't it 6.4% and not 6.71%?
Yes, you're right. 6 points. No, here it's 6.71 and there it's 6.4. So for the zero coupon it was 6.71 and for the 8% 6.4.
That's it.
Okay. Well, then I wish you a very good weekend and I hope to see you next week. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.